Again, good morning, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Pete Novak. I'm the country manager for Cambridge Assessment English for US and Canada, and will be your host for today's webinar. We are thrilled to partner today with California State University Northridge, CSUN for short, Claremont McKenna College, and Tulane University to deliver this webinar for learners. This session will explore a number of aspects of student life on campus, including housing, activities, sports, and the support available, as well as location and climate. In other words, how is it being a student really at a US college or university? This is very, very exciting. Let me share a few suggestions for you to enjoy this session. Please close all other programs if you can. This will help with the connection. Sometimes there may be a delay. Don't worry if that happens. Please just bear with us. In any case, this event is live and it will be recorded and shared afterwards. During the webinar, you will be able to use the chat box for any comments directly to the panel and moderators, and the separate Q&A box. So the Q&A box for any questions to our presenters. The poll function will automatically display for any live polls. If we have a short answer to your question, our moderators will type an answer to you straight away, and they may share some links with you as well. Our presenters will answer as many questions as they can at the end. So don't worry if your question is not answered straight away. So by way of introductions, you are likely familiar with Cambridge Assessment English, since many of you have already taken or are perhaps preparing for one of the Cambridge English exams. For those who are not familiar with Cambridge Assessment English, we are part of Cambridge University Press and Assessment, a department of the University of Cambridge. For well over 100 years, we have been producing a variety of global standard exams and supporting the communities of primary, secondary, and higher education teachers and learners. Our mission is educational, to help people to learn English and to prove their skills to the world. For us, learning English is more than just exams and grades. It's about having the confidence to communicate and access a lifetime of enriching experiences and opportunities. Our qualifications are based on research into effective teaching and learning. They motivate people of all ages and abilities to learn English and develop practical skills for the real world. Each exam focuses on a level of the Common European Framework, helping learners to improve their speaking, writing, reading, and listening skills step by step. Whatever your goals or ambitions, Cambridge English qualifications and exams are a mark of excellence accepted and trusted by more than 25,000 universities, employers, and government departments all over the world for admissions, for recruitment, for graduation, and a whole host of other purposes. For this reason, more than 5.5 million people take our qualifications and tests every year. We have a network of over 50,000 preparation centers in 130 countries, helping you to learn English and take the exam. This webinar today is not focusing on English proficiency exams yet. Participants always ask us right at the beginning, what are the requirements for studying in English, in the US? And I'm happy to say that you can apply across the United States with, in many cases, B2 first, and certainly with C1 advanced and C2 proficiency. That includes the universities and colleges presenting today, although at each institution, different programs will have different requirements. So we always recommend that you take a look at each institution's website for further details. You can visit our global recognition database shown on the slide to see where else are your scores welcome. To share your Cambridge English score, you will need to visit the online results service for candidates on our website, which is displayed on the slide here. You can click on the Send My Result button to securely share your results with your chosen institutions as part of your application. If your chosen institution isn't on there, you can send them an invite, contact their admissions department, and contact us at recognition@cambridgeenglish.org. So that's recognition@cambridgeenglish.org. Here's an example of a screenshot of the next screen you will see after clicking Send My Results button. You can type in your chosen institution into the box, like this example with Tulane University. And so that brings us to our presenters. We are, again, thrilled to have them today with us here, a wonderful group of industry experts. And without further ado, I'm delighted to introduce all three of them. Rochelle Ehrman, Senior Assistant Director of Admissions at Claremont McKenna. Vanessa Andrade, Director of International Programs Partnership Development at CSUN. And Paul Burgess, Director of International Admissions at Tulane University. And so with that, let me hand it over to you, Paul.
Perfect. Thanks so much, Pete. As Pete said, my name is Paul Burgess, Director of International Admission at Tulane University, and I'm going to start us off today just to give you a little bit more perspective for where our institutions are located. You can see this map of our vast country that actually has over 4,000 undergraduate education institutions. We represent just three of them. So two of us over on the West Coast in California, and then Tulane University on the southern coast of the US in a city called New Orleans. And so that is the university I attended. That's the university I represent and the city I call home. So it'll be exciting to talk to you today about that. And we'll transition a little bit into information about Tulane University and the city that I'm located in New Orleans. So our university was founded in the early 1800s, originally exclusively as a STEM-focused or a medical institution. So we've certainly grown a lot from there, but some notable pieces of our history and why I suppose Tulane should potentially be on your radar. It was a Tulane group of scientists that created the first vaccine for yellow fever. So that was something increasingly important as the more tropical and warmer areas of the United States started to grow and develop. So that was quite important for us in our region of the country. And then it was actually a Tulane doctor that also invented the process for open heart surgery, Michael Debakey. So those are some of the alums that we're proud of in the medical field, but Tulane has grown from there to offer a large variety of different programs. So we, of course, still have some science and engineering-based programs that remain quite popular, but we also have a School of Business, a School of Architecture, a School of Public Health, science and engineering. So these different things all remain on option to our students. Probably most uniquely about the undergraduate curriculum is that if you're admitted to Tulane, you are admitted to all programs that we have, from the liberal arts to business to psychology, whatever it might be. There's not a separate application process to be considered for entry into one program or another. You have it all open to you, which is definitely to your advantage, but Tulane also quite notably highly encourages students to double major and take sort of cross-disciplinary studies. When I was at the university, I studied economics and anthropology. So two maybe somewhat disparate seeming areas of study, but I found the research overlap in working specifically with a professor on economic sustainability within remote indigenous communities. We have professors in computer science that work with students in evolutionary biology and ecology to work on mathematic modeling for how migratory patterns of certain species of fish might change with the changing temperatures in our oceans. So all these really unique academic combinations. Tulane has about 8,000 undergraduate students. So we would call that medium size for the US. The majority of our students come from outside of our home state or outside of the US. And most students who come to Tulane don't know anyone else on their first day of class. And that's something that we really like to see. It's that sort of immersive environment overall. A few different rankings up there for what Tulane is perhaps best known for across the world, but lots of other reasons why Tulane could potentially be on your list. Transitioning to the next slide, I think it's important to keep in mind how in the United States, campuses are often what we refer to as residential. That means they function as their own sort of microcosm of a utopia or a miniature city or whatever it might be. So our students live on campus. They might have jobs on campus. They get the majority of their meals on campus. We have our own postal code. We have our own a power plant on campus. So it really functions as this sort of miniature city. And with that come a lot of programs outside of the classroom that remain really important to your choice in university and where you attend. And so community service is one of those. Tulane has 250 different student-run clubs and organizations. That's a pretty standard number for a university of our size. So that means activities that have nothing to do with your major, right? You get to choose based on what interests you and how you see your career trajectory going. And community service is a big one of those. So service can take place based on your interest. I think some quite common options would be working in the public school system, working for an organization called Habitat for Humanity that helps build homes for those in need, working on environmental restoration, some common themes there. But what universities often do, especially for students at that higher academic level, is you're able to directly take what you're learning in the classroom and practice it to the betterment of others in the community around you. So you and your classmates might be paired with a local not-for-profit or community-based organization so that you can utilize your skills and practice them to build up your own experience, but also utilize them to give back. So one of the examples you see here are Tulane architecture students who on an annual basis design a 3-bedroom home with a focus on sustainability. The top design is chosen by a panel of architects at the end of your first semester. And then in the second semester, the university pays for all of the building materials, secures the land, and you physically build that home within the city. So you see your work and design come to life. And then that home is sold at cost, so at a high discount to a needy member of the New Orleans community. So you can really see how your expertise ends up providing housing for someone in need. A variety of different programs as well. What you see here is an after-school program designed for young people in New Orleans, teaching them how to grow their own fresh fruits and vegetables and how to really provide healthy options in food and education and nutrition for their family. So these sort of activities and options for service are really exciting, and they move beyond the traditional, right? Many of you are probably volunteering in your community already, but I think it's important to know that once you transition to the university level, you can start doing that in a way that ties directly to your academics. So some of these things are giving of your physical strengths, but also give of your mental strengths. Let's say you end up studying something like business and accounting. Well, those students will work directly with recent immigrants to the US who have started their own businesses and are filing their US taxes for the first time. So you're able to help give that tax advice you're learning in the classroom to others around you. So transitioning to break down further how service can really play out for students, are a variety of reasons you might choose to do service and a variety of ways that you can really see it come to life around you and enrich you personally as well as academically. So a big piece is to contribute to your community, especially as an international student coming to what is likely a city you have spent little or no time in before. It's a way to feel like an active contributing member of the city around you, to really feel almost enshrined and indoctrinated in this new area that's going to give a lot to you over your 4 years of your undergraduate degree. It's also important for you to give back, understand some of the economic and societal constraints that are in certain lower income parts of the city. All these sort of pieces really add to your overall understanding of your new home and community. You also want to build it into your academic program, right? So this idea of having what you learn in the classroom really function as this gateway to an internship. So being able to have that on your resume, being able to talk about how this service program relates to your future career in job interviews or grad school interviews, fellowship interviews, all of that sort of thing is really enriching. And in addition to that, you can help contribute to perhaps the preservation of an art or a culture. So the image that you see here are students working on historic designs of what are called Mardi Gras Indian outfits, and really making sure that is maintained and exists in documented literature, and not just literature, but textbooks, the design, the intricate patterns, all of that. It's part of our local culture, but it also becomes a part of your academic program. And then also thinking about academic credit for this sort of work, right? And that's maybe more of a US concept, but certainly something that you all have access to through your Cambridge curriculum, right? If you're doing really well in your A-level, your higher level courses that you're taking, you're able to receive university credit for that at many US institutions. That moves you closer towards graduation. The same is true for some of these internships you'll have based on service. Depending on the amount of hours that you contribute and the sort of project that you design for yourself, you can actually get credit towards your degree through this overall sort of work. My favorite personal service organization at Tulane, you saw that little puppy there. We have a whole club, a group of students that actually train service animals for those who have disabilities and need a sort of educated and trained dog to assist them with parts of their daily life. Transitioning from there, another big part of the US experience are athletics. And I think that's maybe stereotypically known around the world through a variety of different movies and TV shows that first and foremost, you are coming to the US for your education, but also somehow athletics and this general competitive nature moves from academics also into the athletic field. And it becomes a big part of the social environment on US campuses. So many universities will have their own stadia for these particular sports. Big ones in the US are going to be American football, baseball, basketball, but also many universities will have more traditional international sports, things like rugby and rowing and crew and equestrian and all these other different ways for you to stay involved in something you're already good at, or maybe something you can learn more about. And these can be televised events. You have the chance to attend these sort of games with other students from around the world and around the US and really show what ends up becoming pride for your university and cheering on those around you. So when we think of the most competitive level of athletics in the US, we call that NCAA competitive sports. And that's a group of students who train for this sort of position years and years and years before they get to campus. But universities also have what are called club and intramural sports. And those take on a little bit more an open access sort of feel. And so transitioning to the next slide, just to talk about club and intramural sports, as well as overall campus recreation. Our universities in the US remain extremely athletic, even not at the most competitive level. So at Tulane, for example, we have 17 of these highly competitive sports, but we have about 30 of these less competitive open access teams. About 75% of our students do participate on one of these teams formally, and that's everything from ultimate frisbee to a Quidditch team to soccer to golf to anything else that you can imagine. And it's just a great way for you to meet people as well. Keep in mind, most students are coming to a totally new environment and that joining one of these teams is a good way to connect with people and potentially learn a new skill. Our universities all will also have on-campus gyms and facilities for you to stay active and healthy. That's, I think, a big part of the American mindset in education is making sure you do stay active. And so that's the indoor Olympic pools and running tracks and weights and spinning classes and yoga classes and all these different ways that you connect with people, but also stay active. In addition to that, I mentioned about competing on campus and against other schools. You'll be able to do that in club and intramural sports as well. So have the competitive nature, but less of the requirement to do so. Recreation in our local areas is also something you're going to find great support for. So the ability to rent out from the university, everything from kayaks to rock climbing equipment, to volleyballs and badminton and all these other sort of things so that you really can stay involved. And so the universities will also often sponsor small outings, overnight trips, to do these sort of activities. And so that's something you don't have to organize yourself. You can just sign up for and go be active and add that sort of co-curricular component to your education. That's the majority of what I have to say. And so we are going to transfer over to our next guest speaker and give you a little bit more information on another vibrant topic. But before that, Vanessa is going to introduce her university. So thank you.
Thanks a bunch, Paul, for getting us off to a good start here in the journey across the US. So shifting gears a bit to the West Coast, to California. My name is Vanessa Andrade, as Pete has introduced earlier on. I'm the Director of International Partnerships at California State University, Northridge. We like to call ourselves CSUN. To put a little bit into context, California State University system is a system that comprises of 23 campuses across California, and it's one of the largest public university systems in the world in higher ed. We mainly focus on undergraduate and graduate degrees. We are, as CSUN, one of the largest of the CSU campuses. And we are located in Los Angeles, in the heart of the entertainment and Hollywood industry, with beautiful weather year-round. And it's a place where I'm happy to call home. CSUN is in the valley of Los Angeles. It's like we would look into more of a university district, sort of a suburb, a little city within Los Angeles. Give you an idea, Los Angeles is a very car culture city. So we measure distances by time driving versus instead of miles or kilometers. So I would say probably we are about a good 45 minutes from Los Angeles International Airport, LAX. We are a good 30 minutes from Hollywood, where the Walk of Fame and a lot of the movie studios industries is located at Universal Studios, the Walt Disney Company. It's all in the area of the San Fernando Valley. We are about an hour from Disneyland, about 45 minutes from Santa Monica Beach, Malibu. So this kind of gives you a little bit of a perspective of the location. CSUN as a university, we are a very comprehensive university. We're very large. We are getting closer to over 40,000 students enrolled in our 9 academic colleges on campus. Out of those, about 3,000 are international students from over 100 different countries. So it's a very diverse university, diverse community within a city itself that it's already diverse. So Los Angeles is a melting pot of cultures from people from all over the world. So that gives you a sense of the welcoming aspect of the campus, the university, and the location we are at. We offer a large number of majors, minors, both as undergrad, and we have about over 70 master's degree programs and very few doctoral programs that are more in the area of education, physical therapy, and so on and so forth. Our average class size is about 27 students, which is a pretty good class size average for a public university at this size. Many majors that we are known for, popular, are more in regards to the media, entertainment, industry, communication, design, arts. Our College of Engineering and Computer Science is internationally accredited by ABET and has many popular majors with international students in there. Our College of Business and Economics is AACSB accredited as well, internationally accredited, and thus is another popular college with international students, as well as some other majors in biology, psychology, the health and industry and sports management and so on and so forth. So that just kind of gives you a comprehensive idea of CSUN. And then let's go more a little bit deep into the next slide when we're gonna talk more about how the whole holistic approach of life at a US university applies. And what I'm saying here, it's the same way as what Paul talked about Tulane. It's applicable at the majority of the over 4,000 undergraduate universities in the US, as a lot of our campuses are really focused on the students in a holistic way, not just academics, but you know, their well-being socially, emotionally, through sports, their health. So that's actually, and getting them ready to the workforce, getting them ready to hit the ground running once they graduate and give them opportunities to establish themselves and their network. And get them started in their careers. So this is a very unique feature of US universities that we're all proud to be part of. Part of those services, looking a little bit at the support services for the students, right? So besides the regular expected support services, it's important to realize that our universities do have a very robust health center where students have access to facilities that include not only doctors, but nurses, pharmacy, chiropractor, practor, massage therapist, acupuncturists, some nutritional guidelines and help with, you know, how to have a balanced meal and so on and so forth. As part of the health center, many of our institutions offer counseling services. And that's specifically helpful or especially helpful for students who may be feeling a little bit of homesick or having a hard time adjusting or having a hard time with, establishing themselves academically in class or being a little bit anxious about what's next once they graduate. So all this counseling service support system does help maintain the students grounded emotionally as well to continue to pursue their academics successfully. A lot of our institutions also have a number of academic support centers to ensure that the students are taken care of if they need an additional help or they're struggling with something. They could include a writing center, a math center, or any other type of student support that help them achieve their academics and enhance their experience at the university. Besides the academic counseling, where you're meeting with your counselors specific to your major or the area of your study, and they will assist you in what's next, what type of courses should you be taking, how do you build your class schedule and course schedule, because we work a little bit different as US institutions than other parts of the world. You are in charge and responsible for building your own course schedules and not necessarily given to you as a set course and schedule with hours beginning, end, and the courses you are taking. So there is some counseling that helps you with that piece of the puzzle, if you would say. A lot of tutoring services, as I mentioned, which kind of go along with support centers for academics. And a number of, for example, student advisors that when people think about international student advisors, the first thing that comes to mind, it's literally immigration assistant and support with I-20s, with documentation and so on and so forth. Yes, you're right. That is an important piece. And those international student advisors are there for that too. But they also are there to help you connect with other international students, other alumni that may be working in your field, give you a breadth of different opportunities to position yourself and share about your culture, do some study abroad options. Yes, you may be in a US institution already studying abroad, but you also have, as part of a lot of our institutions, opportunities to do a semester abroad or a short-term program abroad as part of another service that universities offer to students. So there's a number of student support services that we are here to offer you. So looking forward into that, the next slide, it's expanding a bit on what's next, right, after you graduate. And a big focus on a lot of the students that come and study in the US is their career, jobs, placement, internships. Paul has mentioned some opportunities there when he was talking about community service and how to build your network and how to build your resume. But a lot of our institutions have very solid, robust career services with a lot of support to guide students throughout their 4 years or 2 years of graduate studies here and position them in the workforce. Some of those services offered are career counseling, because sometimes you don't know, you have an idea of who you wanna be or where you wanna be or who you wanna work for, but you need sometimes a little bit of more self-assessment and help from a career counselor that kind of can give you some roadmaps and self-assessments and look into your resume, give you some interview tips, do some mock interviews and so on and so forth. And all those services are included in the career services as part of the US institutions and universities breadth of opportunities provided to you. The career services also, it's a great place to build your professional network because there's tons of local employees that connect with university campuses in order to find somebody that could be a good future employee or offer an internship or come and meet prospects for their job fairs. There is a huge alumni network that is connected to the career services and centers, and alumni tend to be a very strong advocate for the students on their own campuses. So it's very important that that you connect with the alumni centers and the alumni network for your future experience. Workforce readiness, how to have hands-on experience, how to find campus jobs, off-campus jobs. And for international students specifically, a lot of the OPT or CPT guidance, optional practical training, the curriculum practical training, which are the OPT, for example, it's the 12 months or up to 3 years if you are graduating from a STEM major that you can work in the US legally in your area of expertise upon graduation. And the CPT is the one that you do alongside and while you are attending university. So this gives you a little bit of an idea of services offered at the Career Center. And the next slide will give you also a perspective on the other job fairs and related type of assets that you can have. This is just an example of a couple of events that we have at CSUN. Our counselors are also working hybrid. So there's a lot of daily Zoom and in-person hours. So students can choose how they prefer to do that. We do have job fairs, and we have a program called Handshake, where a lot of job opportunities, both on campus and off campus, are advertised to our students, including internship opportunities. We do have an international pathway speaker series at CSUN that is very popular with our international students, where we bring members of the international community and show what was their pathway into their careers and their jobs and where they are. And students get to ask them questions on how they got there, right? And one new component that we implemented this year as part of our intensive English program that we also offer on our campus is a career pathway element. So let's assume that you do not yet have the English proficiency to attend a US institution. You could, for example, at CSUN come through our intensive English program. But if you already know that your interest, for example, is in the entertainment industry, you take alongside the intensive English program a career pathway where you're going to be learning elements of the entertainment industry, vocabulary, jargons, and get yourself positioned well there. Same goes for engineering, same goes for business. So that's another benefit that helps you start establishing yourselves for your job interviews, your resumes, and your future careers. Next slide, we're going to be talking a little bit about another topic that Paul hit a little bit on, but it's all the sports activities, and especially the student clubs and organizations that our institutions offer. So at CSUN, for example, we do currently have over 300 student clubs on campus. And usually when we go talk to international students about student clubs, they immediately think about, oh, sports, right? And that is the first thing that comes to their mind. But just to give you an idea here, we listed some ideas of what are those clubs, right? And how important they are for your experience into a US university, not only to network, to meet friends, to be part of a community, but also connect you with people with similar interests or connect you with an area that you want to explore more or learn more, or you've always showed or expressed interest in, but never had the opportunity to continue exploring, or an area that's connected to your academic field, your areas of study, your research. So there's so many different variations of clubs that students can be a part of that it's just fascinating to see the club fairs every year when, you know, all the club, student-driven clubs present and try to gather more participants to join them. Some examples of the ones at CSUN when it comes to sports clubs, besides the regular ones, we have archery, we have esports, which is it's becoming very popular here, hip hop or boxing or tennis, some special interest clubs like women in entertainment, that's a big one right now, ceramics if you are interested in ceramics, or cultural clubs like the Jewish Student Center, Black male scholars, Latino journalists. So there's so many different variations, more targeted to community services, a sociology club, a peer health exchange club, more targeted to housing, you know, the fraternity or the sororities clubs, the Alpha Phi, Delta Gamma, or Delta Sigma, and all those Greek names that are very popular in US campuses that offer housing. The Honors Club, which is more academics for students that are looking into a deeper dive into their academics. Like, for example, we have a biology student committee club, a business honors association program, and then some related to religions, right? Asian American Christian Fellowship and Catholic Newman Club and department programs and university programs, more academic targeted based on college, academic colleges, like the Communication Association or Aeronautics Club or Associated Students Club that puts a lot of events on campus year round. So these are just exciting opportunities and offerings that US institutions have for their students on campus. And it's definitely a great part of being an international student on campus. As being one myself, I'm originally from Brazil, so I've experienced this firsthand, and it definitely changed the way I approached and saw how higher ed and education is compared to what I had in my home country. So I guess this is it for me. We are moving on to our next guest speaker from Claremont McKenna College. Back to you or on you, Rochelle. Thank you.
All right. Thank you so much, Vanessa. Hi, everyone. My name is Rochelle Ehrman. I'm a senior assistant dean of admission at Claremont McKenna, and I'm one of our two international staff. So thank you again for coming today. I'm going to start with a very brief overview of CMC. Located not too far from our neighbors at CSUN, CMC is located in Claremont, California, which is in Los Angeles County, but is about 35 miles east of Los Angeles, east of downtown, which can take anywhere from 40 minutes to a little bit more than that, depending on traffic. We are located only about 10 minutes from the mountains, which is on this map on the right-hand side of your screen, but like, I don't know if you can read it. I'm having a little trouble. It might be a little small, but we're about 10 minutes from the mountains, a little over an hour from, you know, downtown and Hollywood, the beaches. We're close to Joshua Tree and Coachella. So our students definitely, you know, take trips out that way. And we're part of the five Claremont Colleges, also known as the Five C's or the Claremont Consortium or the Claremont Colleges. There are five undergraduate liberal arts colleges that are located right next to each other and operate as a consortium. So you can see on that map that we really are right next to each other. You know, at CMC, you can walk across the street and be on Pomona's campus. You can walk across the street in the other direction and be on the Scripps campus. So we really are very close together, and that does create some integration across the colleges, but you do need to apply to every school individually, and we do operate as individual institutions. CMC itself has about 1,350 undergraduate students, fully undergraduates, that's everyone. And there are about 6,000 students across the consortium. So you're getting a very small, intimate liberal arts experience at CMC while partaking in sort of a larger social experience. So you don't feel like you're in, you know, a very small bubble. CMC is about 17% international students, with students coming from over 40 countries. And again, like, that even gets expanded upon by our neighbors who have international students as well. CMC probably has the highest percentage of international students among the five colleges, but there are large groups of additional international students outside of CMC. So you have, you know, your International Connect, which is our CMC international student group, but you also have like the other international students and the larger international student groups for all 5C students in the consortium. So it's a really robust social experience as well as academic experience. Our average class size is 17 students. So we are a small college with an 8-to-1 student to faculty ratio. We do not have teaching assistants at CMC. You will always be taught by a professor. We offer about 38 of our own majors at CMC, but you can also major at the other colleges. You can also take classes at the other colleges. As a student at CMC, you can register for a class at any other 5C college, the same way that you would register for a class at CMC. So maybe there's, I don't know, a history class at Pomona that really interests you. You can sign up for it on the same system. It's the same calendar. It's the same number of credits. It doesn't cost you anything extra. So our students definitely take advantage of the consortium when it comes to academics. Majority of students do major at CMC, but you definitely have that opportunity. If there is something that catches your eye at one of the other colleges, maybe it's organizational studies at Pitzer. One of our students is a German studies major at Pomona. It really allows for more flexibility. CMC's core values revolve around our ideas of responsible leadership. So we were founded as an institution in 1946 at the end of World War II to be a place that educates responsible leaders, to be a school that brings in leadership and pre-professional development to the liberal arts, which makes us definitely a unique liberal arts college, and is what makes us stand out among the other four colleges in the consortium that I was talking about. We are a community of scholars and leaders and problem solvers. Our students are very forward thinking, and we have a lot of opportunities for you to gain pre-professional experience as a student before you graduate. Almost 80% of our students conduct research. We have 11 research institutes that operate on our campus. So those are all independently endowed and run by faculty and staff at CMC. You can start doing research your first semester. You can apply to the research institutes your first semester on campus, and we have students who start doing research right away. We have other students who wait. We have other students who choose not to do it. It's really up to you. You can also do research with all of our academic departments, as well as in all of the STEM fields. So we have 11 institutes. They obviously don't cover every topic that you can research, but between the institutes and the academic departments in our Keck Science Center, there's a really, really robust ability to do research. The second thing is internships. 95% of our students complete at least one internship before they graduate. Over half of our students do three before they graduate. So our SOL Center for Student Opportunity works really, really closely with students to find what interests them, which is not dependent on your major. You can be an economics major and be pre-med and want to go into health sciences. You can be a history major and be interested in consulting. So it's up to your interests, not just your major. But we help you take what you're learning in class and put it into action in your internship opportunities. And then we fund internships that are unpaid or underpaid. We spend almost $2 million on this every year for students who don't get paid or don't have enough money to live on for the summer, we will supplement that and we will give you the money to spend the summer doing that internship experience so that you have your pre-professional experiences. So CMC is just it's a very different kind of liberal arts college, but a liberal arts college at its core. We have a general education requirement, which takes up about a third of your classes. And we are really committed to making sure that students get a very broad education as well as a very in-depth education in their major or double major or anything else that they choose to study or do at CMC, with that focus on what we call learning for the sake of doing, being able to take it what you're learning in class and apply it to what you're doing outside of the classroom, with a very robust on-campus life as a residential college and a very robust international student experience as well. So move on to my portion of student life. So we'll start with orientation programs. So you may be familiar with orientation programs. There's a few different ways that this can be done. It is very common for international students to have orientation before orientation. So what we like to call like international student orientation. So you'll come to campus a little bit early. So let's say, you know, the move-in date for all students is August 30th. Maybe you'll come August 27th or 28th. So you'll come in a few days early. And you'll be able to connect just with your the other international students, both new students and current upperclassmen who serve as your guides typically, and then staff and faculty who are also available to you on campus. And it helps you get acclimated to the United States before, you know, everybody else comes and you also have to get acclimated to the college and the orientation process. Orientation can be overwhelming as a domestic student. I remember it being a very overwhelming experience at times, but that's why you have these really incredible other student, staff, and faculty to help guide you through it. And that's why we want you to get an even a little bit more time to get acclimated as an international student, because you have, you know, even more of an adjustment, not just because you might be coming from a 12-hour time difference and you need a little bit more time to adjust. So usually it's a couple of days early. Our students, for example, will like go on trips to Target and get, you know, additional things that you couldn't bring, like maybe bedding and a pillow if you couldn't get that in your suitcase. And after a couple of days, the rest of the new class will come and you'll do a full orientation where you learn more about resources, academics, student life. There's usually like meet and greets with different academic departments and resources on campus and fun activities to bond with other students and get to know the people in your dorms. So it's a really awesome experience and there are a lot of benefits. It helps you make new friends. Or most schools do some sort of like groups, like you're in some sort of orientation group. At CMC, we have a special part of orientation that's called the Wilderness Outdoor Adventure Program, which is a trip that you take that is usually in the wilderness outdoors. So it's usually some sort of like camping trip. Some students go beach camping, some go cabin camping nearby. And you know, the groups that form around that are really, really tight knit. It's called WOE, and a lot of students call each other their WOMIs. And I have heard endless stories about students who are still friends 2-3 years later with the kids from their WOE group, and their leader, their first year guide, who was, you know, incredible in their experience at CMC and really changed everything for them. So there really is such a benefit to being in these groups. It also gets you acclimated to where everything is on campus. CMC has a slightly smaller campus because we are a smaller college, but within the 5 C's, it can get very confusing when you're walking around different campuses. So it's a really good way to learn about them. You generally will register for classes, meet with your advisor, learn about other support services, tutoring, writing centers. For us, we also, you know, do meet and greets with our professional development resources, and just gets you generally prepared for that first year on campus. So orientation, big fan. I think it's a really, really valuable part of the first year experience. All right, residential life. So residential life looks a little bit different at every college. CMC is a fully residential college, and we guarantee housing for 4 years. Not all schools do that. Some schools guarantee housing for 2 years or 3 years. Some are commuter schools. So you do definitely need to pay attention to that when you're applying. It doesn't necessarily need to be a deal breaker, any reason you shouldn't apply or go to a college. It's just something really to be aware of when you're applying so that you're not caught off guard later on. So there are a couple different types of housing. So residence halls and dorms are probably the most common US housing options. Dormitories, I think the most common analogy is like to a hotel almost. So you have, but you would have like a, you have like a shared bathroom on the floor, and then you have different rooms, and each room can be like a double or a single, sometimes a triple. So usually like one, two or three students living in each room. And you get to know the students who are, you know, down the hall from you, you get to know your roommates really well. And then some colleges also offer suite style living. That's usually multiple bedrooms that are connected in a common space or through a bathroom, or apartment style housing. Generally, apartment style housing is reserved for upperclassmen in most cases. But campus apartment style housing is really a great benefit because you get to live basically in an apartment with your own kitchen, bathroom, separate rooms, and you can cook for yourself and really take care of yourself, but it's done through the college. So also if like something breaks, you don't have to like call a plumber, you can just call your college and they'll come fix it for you. So there's a lot of different types of these housings, and it does depend a little bit on the school and what kind of housing you prefer. Generally you'll have roommates. Most colleges will have some sort of housing process. For first year students, you may be matched. Like we do at CMC, you fill out a survey about yourself and then we match you with and one or two other students who has a similar personality or likes, dislikes that you do. Some schools do let you choose your first roommate. Generally after that first year, if you're looking for housing for your sophomore year or your junior year, you also get to choose your roommate or roommates. It's a really awesome way to just meet more students, get to know each other, make really good lifelong friends. There are certain types of housing called themed housing, which can be around different topics. So there's sometimes like language houses, like everybody in this house practices a certain language, or, you know, everybody's taking a foreign language and this is the place where we can come together and talk about it. There are also ones that are like interest housing, like maybe there's a philanthropy house for students who are interested in volunteering, or students who are involved in religious life might have one. Can be done by class year. It can be done by gender. Some schools are gender neutral in their housing. Some divide students by gender by floor. So like first floor would be female, second floor would be male, something like that. So there's a lot of different ways that we can divide, that you can, you know, choose where you live and get divided up. And why would you want to live on campus? Why wouldn't you want to live on campus? I loved living on campus as a student. And I think a lot of our students at CMC really value it. It is, first of all, it's just a little bit easier sometimes. You can walk to class. You have like much more access to the other dorms where your friends might be living, to the resident, or sorry, to the dining halls. It's easier to get to class. You can sleep in a little bit more, but also you'll have a little bit more access during the day to some of the resources on campus. You don't always have to worry about, you know, driving to school and what's the traffic going to be like, and am I going to be late for class? Don't get me wrong, plenty of our students are late for class because even if they're walking across the street, it happens all the time. You also have a little bit more access to like the social events on campus, because again, like you don't have to worry about parking or getting home or anything like that. So students definitely like have a little bit more of an immersed experience in the social aspect of the campus when they're living there. And it just allows you to be closer with the other students and have, you know, you might just like run into someone out late or in the library or in a computer lab or something like that. It just really builds your social network and your ability to connect with other students and with the college and have access, easy access to all the things on campus. All right. And I think now we're going to open it up for some Q&A. Am I right about that?
Yes, thank you, Rochelle. Excellent. So we have a couple of minutes for questions. Let's see, we have 7 open questions. Let's start with in the US context from Aitor, I hope I pronounced your name correctly. Can you explain the difference between college and university, and how does that relate to student life, if there's any relation in there? Who would like to quickly answer that?
I can throw it out really quick. Generally, the difference between a college and a university is a college is completely undergraduate, and a university typically has undergraduate and graduate programs. That's the most general definition. I went to a college that was completely undergraduate, except we had one graduate program, so we were technically a university. So like, sometimes it's really more undergraduate, but generally that's the difference. And it definitely can change the student life aspect of it. Universities, because they also have graduate programs, are for the most part a lot larger, which can create more opportunities, more clubs, more organizations. It does also mean like sometimes, you know, larger classes or a larger social experience. So there's definitely that aspect to it. And when there are graduate students on campus, you are going to interact with graduate students in a way that you wouldn't necessarily at a college. I think for the most part, our students at CMC like don't really interact with graduate students on a day-to-day basis. But I'm sure Vanessa can talk a little bit more about this. I'm sure her students interact with graduate students on a day-to-day basis.
Yeah, but I think you gave a good explanation. I don't know if Paul wants to add, but another thing that tends to be very impactful there is the universities most likely are residential. So a lot of them have campus housing and many colleges do not. So it's also another area that can help or not with student interaction and community building. So.
Excellent.
Yeah, nothing more to add.
Thank you. And we have some questions around what exact sports are available or specific degrees available. I would suggest to take a look at each institution's website, because there is the menu is longer than we can take time to go over and multiply that by 4,000 institutions. We have a great question from Gayatri. Is it possible to stay in the on-campus housing during the summer breaks and work for international students? Who would like to, Paul, would you like to?
Yeah, gladly. So yes, most universities are going to have an option for you to stay on campus over the summer, and a variety of employment options for you as well. Everything from helping with large scale conferences we have over the summer to staffing the libraries or athletic facilities. I'm also working as a student resident advisor for other students who are doing summer school. Our campuses all have that residential component to it. And because of that, so many jobs that need to be filled. So there will usually be an option for you there. Specifically, if you're coming to the US on an F1 student visa, there are stipulations in that visa that do allow you to work for an extended period of time for pay over the summer breaks. So you have the employment authorization to work up to 40 hours per week during the summer break on your university's campus. So that's a kind of full work week. And so that's, yes, exciting, a great way to spend more time on campus and also bring in a little bit of an income.
Excellent. Rochelle or Vanessa, would you like to add anything else to that?
No, that was perfect.
I think the only thing I would add was that it also applies to other breaks, like winter break and spring break.
That's a great point. And because folks are coming from different parts of the world, when are the large breaks in terms of, you know, how they schedule their time and so forth? How does it work in the US? And that's going to be the last question for today.
If you're on the semester system, usually there is a very long break in the summer. It's usually from like early mid-May through mid to late August. And then there's a longer winter break that's usually 4 to 5 weeks. That's probably like mid-December through mid-January. It again varies. So those are the two biggest breaks. And then most schools have a break in the spring for 1 or 2 weeks called spring break. And in the fall, there's Thanksgiving break, which can be a couple of days, it can be a whole week around American Thanksgiving, which is at the end of November. And usually there's also a fall break, which is generally just a couple of days. For us, it's usually in October. I think it depends a little on the school.
And just one thing to add there. I know we talked about housing availability during breaks, but remember, campus houses housing includes meals, includes you know, facilities on campus and meal plans. The only trick is some universities may have limited hours on the dining facilities with meal plans during breaks, depending on the number of students who stay on campus. But all the services are provided, not just the housing, but it's everything around housing during the breaks too.
Excellent. Well, thank you. That will conclude our session today. And so a really big thank you to our presenters, Paul, Rochelle, and Vanessa, for this informative presentation. There's a lot to take in there. So, and also thank you to the great questions from the participants. Please do look for an email with useful links and the recording of this webinar. There's a lot in here, including links. You will have an email. You can look at the details again. And again, thank you so much for all the questions. We hope that you found this session helpful, and we would certainly appreciate your feedback on based on the survey that we are sharing. And I would just say before closing that keep an eye out. This was part of a webinar series for learners. Keep an eye out on the next webinar, which will be this summer on this webinars for learners page. So with that, we wish you all the best in your academic journeys, wherever that may take you. Stay safe. And till next time, all the best. Thank you.
Thank you.